Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Conflict by Matthew Peed, narrated by Gabriel Vaughan and Eva Kaminsky. Chapter 1. Regan. Looking over the giant crater that was now my front door, I considered what I wanted to do with the wide, gaping space. Thanks to a certain shadow dragon, I would have to redo nearly half my dungeon. It would take some mana to fix this, but I wanted to have a decent idea on how I was going to build it before I invested the mana. I could have just reset it back to the square maze, but that seemed like a waste. I knew a lot more and could make it even more interesting than before. I felt a tug on my arm and turned. Alara stood beside me, looking tired. I smiled and created a chair for her to sit in. After I'd defeated her dungeon and shattered her core, a certain type of magic had taken over, at least according to Ignia. It wasn't quite a slave pact, or even that weird dragon mating magic that Nova used on Morka. Alara retained all her abilities in her dungeon, but I had control over it. The closest thing to it would be my subcores. Still, I didn't plan on ordering her to do anything, and she didn't have to listen to me even if I did. I really didn't understand the point of it until a few hours ago when a monster wandered into her aura, which was still considerably big even with her core still repairing itself. When the guards I'd left with her core killed it, I felt the flow of mana that was released, and part of it went to me. So, it just expanded my idea that it was basically a subordinate core now. It would be enlightening to see how long this binding lasted. Plus, it gave me some interesting ideas to try out later, but I didn't want to risk anything while I was still so low on mana. That was another reason to get my dungeon back up. The adventurers needed a reason to stay in town. If their source of income was gone, they would have to leave to find something else. "Here you go," I said as I helped her sit. I was still enthralled by her beauty. It was a sort of ethereal thing, her hair cascading down her back, the paleness of her skin, her eyes that appeared to see the truth of the world around her. The black metal crown still rested on her head, and her sword still hung at her waist, markings from her time under the necromancer's control. From what I understood, they were seared into her mental image of herself, so it would take a long time before she would stop creating them when she formed her avatar. The sword had a level of magic that was almost on par with Azal's Feuer. They caused a contrast that I felt just made her all the more beautiful. She nodded her thanks and leaned back in the chair. If someone were to pass by, they might mistake her for a doll by how still she went. I just shook my head at the surrealness of the sight. I turned back to the area around me. Thinking about the necromancers gave me an interesting idea. I reshaped the crater a bit, but left it mostly the same. Now, the magic that governed the dungeons recognized that the space it occupied were my floors. I pulled up the automata that would normally be on these floors. Tweaking them a bit, I made them look damaged and in need of repair. This would make it easier for adventurers to penetrate the outer layer of the crater. The automata grew more dangerous the closer to the center you came. After a few hours, I had the first layer completed. A bare crater would be boring, so I added a junkyard environment to the floor. The junk metal I added was worthless and would break into dust as soon as someone picked it up. I also used other things, like destroyed stone golems, to decorate the area. I felt it came out quite nice. I wasn't too worried about people flying over the junkyard straight to the entrance to the next set of floors. Mages and warriors high enough to do that could easily just battle their way through after all, and I would just be suffering losses by forcing them to fight. I had to think about rewards for these floors. A lot of the adventurers used to farm the greed traps, and I couldn't have that anymore. I was still trying to deal with the massive amount of gold I'd put into the market. Then again, part of the draw for the valley was the high payout. I tapped my chin, deciding to come back to it later. Moving over to a pile of junk, I created a trap inside. a machine gun placement that would rise and target anything that came within 30 meters of it. I kept the caliber down, though, so as long as an adventurer had a decent quality shield, they would be able to survive a few hits. This was only the first floor. I gave it a set amount of ammunition as well. It would be random in order to stop people from figuring it out easily. Once the turret was disabled, whether from waiting it out or by actual damage to the weapon, the party would find a chest with some coins in it. I made it so that the trap could judge how they achieved it. That way, if someone charged the weapon and survived, they would get more coins than someone who sat it out. I didn't want to flood the market again, so I kept it in the silver range. The mine was also gone. That had been the largest draw for many people living in the town. I snapped my fingers as an idea hit me. Though I kept to the lower tier of metals, I placed them where a person could get to relatively safely, a happy medium. Metal veins through the crater. This would allow people to mine. At the center of the crater, I recreated the entrance to the dungeon. Only this time, I went for overkill. The mech I'd made in Alara's dungeon now sat over the entrance, which was made of massive titanium double doors. The mech was mostly repaired, but I'd left its armor battle scarred for effect. Runes of all kind were traced on its surface. I wanted it to be a testament to how far my magical knowledge had advanced since I'd come to this world. There were times that I felt I'd cheated since my dungeon senses helped a great deal. However, I knew that even a dungeon would have a challenging time matching my speed in learning magic. Starfall, back in its spear form, went into the mech's hands. He looked like a guardian deity. I just hoped that didn't cause anyone to freak out and not dive into the dungeon. If it did, I would cross that bridge when I came to it. The saddest part about the dungeon floor being turned to rubble was that Colossus and the framework for his boss creation were completely destroyed by Morka pulverizing her way through. I considered what to do about the boss. I needed something to fit the theme of the floor. But Colossus had always been too powerful, in my opinion. It was good while I was weaker, but now I didn't mind people getting deeper. The strength of the people living here needed to be raised so they could defend themselves. Thinking about what I wanted to create, I channeled mana into a creation spell. I kept the flow low, however, as I didn't need another Nova. A humanoid form quickly took shape in front of me. Grasping a gun, cannon-like in both shape and size, it possessed a lot of rusted parts and wore overalls. Its face was more like a mask with only one eye, which flickered on, and it looked at me. Wires made up its hair, reminding me of dreadlocks. I always made sure to give my creations the ability to talk. However, after Colossus's change, this time I waited to see what I was dealing with.
"Creator, thanks for giving me life, man," it said with a fist bump.
His tone was masculine. "Ah, no problem. What should we call you?" I asked, not even surprised anymore.
"I be leaving it to you. You the boss," he said as he pulled something off his belt.
A slot opened on his faceplate, and he inserted what looked like a pipe. A moment later, he blew out a stream of steam.
"Ah, that be the stuff there."
I looked around at the junkyard, trying to think up a name. I wish I had one of those websites like Back on Earth where it would randomly generate a name for you. It gets hard to think up a name every time you create something. I tapped my chin for a moment as I looked at the piles of junk before I finally came up with something, though it wasn't the least bit original. "Collector, that will be your name," I said.
"Sweet, man," Collector said, hefting his cannon.
He walked over to a pile of junk and placed his foot on it. It slowly morphed into a set of trees and a hammock. I just closed my eyes as he placed his cannon on the ground and jumped into the hammock.
"You know your job, right?" I asked. "Kill some people," Collector said with a poof of steam.
"Good enough for now," I said with a sigh. I rubbed my head, then made my way to where I felt Alara.
I walked it to get a feel for what the adventurers might experience. It wasn't too oppressive, and I figured they shouldn't have too much trouble once they got used to it. I was a few hundred meters away from where I left Collector when I heard an explosion and spun around. A figure flew in the air, dodging flak from the blasts. Moving my focus over, I realized that Louella was flying into the main dungeon. She wasn't technically in it yet, so I hadn't been paying attention to her. The problem was that she was almost directly above the entrance and, by extension, Collector. I teleported over to Collector and told him to stop firing.
"The fly was annoying me," Collector said with a shrug.
"Louella is welcome in my dungeon. It'd be best if you remembered that," I said tersely.
"You the boss."
Collector shouldered his cannon and went back to lounging. I turned just as Louella was landing. Her clothes were covered in soot, but she looked unharmed. I was impressed at her expression, which merely said, "It's no different from what I expected." "Evening, Viscountess. What can I do for you?" I asked with a playful bow.
"I received reports that changes were happening to the outside of the dungeon. I wanted to check up on you, but was suddenly attacked, not that it hurt."
She gave me a sly glance and began dusting herself off.
"Next time I'll message ahead."
"Sorry, just made him and he didn't know better," I said with a grin. That was the interesting thing I'd come to learn about the dungeon. It was a living entity on its own. My consciousness made up the driving force that directed it, but the individuals inside, especially the intelligent ones, had what might be called a social life. The automata calling individuals selected was an example of this.
"Whatever. As long as it doesn't kill me, I don't care anymore. Lekazar is in chaos, and I wanted to know how your mana reserves were coming."
"Better. Had a massive expenditure 2 nights ago, however, that put me almost back to empty." I looked inside my dungeon to Goblin City, taking note of the 1,000-plus airships that were anchored around the city. I'd built the city for a population of nearly 1 million. There was plenty of space for them to live comfortably.
"I see. Refugees are flooding into the valley. I was hoping you could make shelter for them. It doesn't have to be extravagant, but winter is only a stone's throw away. We will have many people dying if they are forced to weather the cold," Louella said, concern coloring her features.
"I understand. The massive influx of people is good for me. At this rate, we'll reach 400,000 in a few days. Wow, I haven't checked it in a while. How did the number get so high?"
The figure surprised me. No wonder my mana levels hadn't bottomed out. With that many people, I was getting somewhere near 2 to 3 million mana an hour. The wonderful thing about getting mana from people was that it was never cut when I went up a rank or level. "A massive wave of Terra decimated just about every village and town on the continent. The cities survived due to some ancient magic left behind. This event was almost worse than the necromancer attack," Louella explained, then placed her hands on her hips. "You wouldn't know anything about this?"
I turned around to look at the mountains as if thinking about it. "Whoops, what was the death toll?" I asked more seriously.
"Thankfully, it wasn't too bad, all things considering. According to the reports, forests and dungeons in the path of the wave reduced its power. As it came in swells, most people were able to evacuate buildings before they collapsed. In fact, villages built in forested areas were almost unaffected."
"That's good." I heaved a sigh of relief and turned back around. "All right, please empty the west fields tomorrow. I'll make a new district for the refugees, though people might want to live there more once they see it. I'll leave the distribution up to you."
"What about the fields? Even if they have a place to live, it won't matter without food,"
Louella said, crossing her arms as she thought the problem over. "No worries. You remember the 9th floor? I asked and got a nod. "I plan on making a floor that will be passive and entirely for farming. I want to turn the valley into a sprawling city someday,
but I don't want you to rely on outside sources for food. Any farmer who wants to work a field will get a silver for working 12 hours on the farming floor.
Are you sure? Your floors are meant to be a way to protect yourself, aren't they?
Yes, and making everyone in 1,000 kilometers fall in love with the foods and produce farmed in my dungeon is one way to do that. You've seen my restaurant. All that food was from things made or bred in the dungeon, I explained with a chuckle.
Thank you. Really, I appreciate everything you've done for me, Louella said, bowing her head.
I chuckled again and waved her off. Give and take, my dear, give and take.
She smiled, then I sensed a magnetic field form around her as she shot into the air. She was quickly out of sight. Teleporting back to Alara, I found her right where I left her. In fact, it didn't look like she had moved a centimeter. I kneeled in front of her chair and ran a hand down her cheek.
Wake up, Alara. Time to head back inside, I said gently. She still frightened easily, especially when awakened.
Her eyes shot open and locked on mine, and her rapid breathing slowly calmed. I smiled softly and held out my hand. She took it, and I helped her to her feet. She looked up to my shoulders. My avatar was a bit over 3 meters tall and had wide shoulders. She pointed to them, and I tilted my head quizzically.
Go ahead, I said, not sure what was going on.
She suddenly jumped, the most movement I'd seen her do since our fight. She landed perfectly on my shoulder and sat there. I heard a sigh of relief or happiness. I wasn't quite sure. I laughed and started walking back into the dungeon, enjoying the company.
Chapter 2. Regan. I was walking through what would be considered the 10th floor. I had already moved the other floors down. The fort was the only thing that made an impact here, and the rest of the dungeon floor was rolling plains. When I had a little more mana, I was planning on expanding it to the 10-floor theme. I wanted to have homesteads here so people could claim a spot as theirs and work it on a rented basis. My mana ocean was sitting at a few million, but I didn't feel very comfortable about it and wanted to give it a few days to build up. There was never a safe number when it came to mana, in my opinion. You could never have too much. When you were a dungeon core, you needed mana like a mortal needed air to breathe. Alara was tired again, so I brought her to the core room. While I was placing her in bed, I felt something in my tower at the center of town. It had been a while since I had even gone in it. The cultivation stones were still being sold, but it was all automatic. I actually saw it as Gray and Anna's home. Curious to see who was calling me, I teleported over.
Dungeon host, I wish to converse with you, said a little girl that couldn't have been more than 10.
She was filthy, or at least her clothes were. Her hands and face looked like they had been recently washed. She possessed interesting silver eyes that almost appeared to be made of mana. In fact, when I looked at her with my dungeon senses, I saw that mana was behaving strangely around her, almost like it was trying to get her attention.
Hello, little girl, I said, materializing a few meters in front of her. Hearing some steps on the stairs, I turned to see Anna being led by Gray. They must have heard the girl shouting for me.
Anna, Gray, I'll take care of this. Please return upstairs. She obviously wants to speak to me alone, I said, motioning for the golem to take the blind elf with him. The eyes of this girl were not a young child's, I noted, as she glared at both of them with the intelligence of someone much older. She had seen something that had forced her to grow up. I idly wondered what she could have gone through to cause such a thing.
Yes, Lord Regan, Anna said, then patted Gray's hand to have her lead him back.
Now, what is your name? I said, turning back to the girl.
Sophia, she said simply.
I had to stop myself from chuckling. She wasn't giving me much to work on. Hundreds of refugees came into town every day. Was she an orphan, or did she run away from home? Either way, she appeared to know what she wanted, or at least had a solid goal.
All right, Sophia, I said, conjuring a pair of chairs for us. What can I do for you? She sat down and stared at me. I wasn't sure if she was scared or what, as I couldn't get a read on her emotions. It reminded me a little of the first robots I'd built with learning AI. A few days on the internet always left them speechless. I waited patiently for her to decide what she wanted to say. A few minutes later, she finally spoke.
I want to bind myself to the dungeon.
Well, that certainly surprised me. Not something a 10-year-old child should want, let alone know about. I leaned forward and put my chin on my hands. From what I knew, binding her to the dungeon would be permanent. It was one of the paths I had not explored extensively due to it being easier for me to just create new children from magic. Before the person suffered a personality change, as was the case with Azra, I needed to understand a bit more of the situation. My understanding of magic was greater, and I knew I could more fully control the mental component of the spell. Still, to request something like this, I knew she wasn't an average child. She spoke with too much sophistication for that. Why? Sophia looked at the ground before she replied.
I just spent a month traveling to get here while avoiding my own people, all while everyone around us was fleeing as refugees, all because of my sister. If I couldn't trust my own flesh and blood, how can I trust anyone else?
Sophia looked up with tears in her eyes. Can you trust me? I asked.
I don't have to. The magic behind the bond requires both parties to agree. I have only one requirement. Do not betray me. You can do whatever you want with me. Force me to kill people, make me go to war. I don't care, as long as you do not betray me.
I considered for a moment. How do you know what I consider betrayal is the same as you? I could consider killing you to be an act of love, I said, leaning back in my chair. Sophia thought that over for a moment. Obviously, she was smart for her age and had a very good upbringing. I was debating whether changing her was even a good idea.
Then how about this? Treat me like one of your daughters. I heard the cores treat the creatures they create like family. Do that for me rather than treating me like an outsider.
I thought it over. Even if she was the daughter of some noble, I wasn't too afraid of anything they could do. The entire continent was currently in upheaval. They had too much on their hands to deal with a single child. Plus, the girl obviously didn't trust mortals anymore. If I left her alone, it might not be long before she descended on a path that might later be hard to return from. Then there was the fact that I was interested in why the mana was reacting the way it was to her. Very well. I welcome you to the family, I said, standing up and holding out my hand for her to shake. She got up slowly, exhaustion showing on her face. I wondered how long it had been since she'd gotten some real sleep. She reached out and clasped my hand. I couldn't help but notice how small her hand was and the obvious trials it had endured. I was not expecting what happened next. Like gravity had been increased several fold, the ground cracked in a circle around us. I grinned at her, even more intrigued. I was always most interested when magic was related. I certainly loved science, but magic was this world's science. I loved to learn more about it. A magical contract formed between us with my name already signed on it. Sophia read it over with what I could tell was quite a bit of understanding. She would have made a good lawyer on Earth, as she would read a section multiple times, making sure she understood it correctly. At points, she even asked me to clarify a few items. She managed to read the entire thing even with the mana pressing down on us. Then, upon being satisfied at what it said, she brought her finger up to the document and quickly signed. There was a moment of tension as all sound died. Then, with a surge of mana all around us, my own mana rushed into her. And not only mine, but the ambient mana as well. As the bond formed between us, I glimpsed the desire inside her. She wanted an entirely new form. She wanted to leave being mortal behind, leave being weak behind. Seeing that,
I decided it was a good thing I'd gone through with this. That sort of desire could lead people down paths they would later come to regret. I had little control over the magic by this point, and could only watch as the mana flooded into her. Her pale skin changed to a silver metal. Her hair turned into strands of blonde wire that looked so much like regular hair, it was almost impossible to tell the difference until you touched it. There was a high chance that it would slice your finger. She grew a few centimeters and was only a little shorter than Alara now. The tower shuddered as the pressure from the mana, or rather gravity, increased farther. Honestly worried the thing might collapse, I made sure to continue to channel the mana, but the spell called for more. I didn't want to damage her new form by allowing the magic to fail. Arcs of energy raced over her skin, burning her filthy clothes with the intense heat being generated from the interacting magic. Finally, the changes were complete. Sophia dropped into my arms as I reached out to catch her from falling, most likely completely spent mentally. I wondered if anyone would even be able to recognize her now. I examined the mana emanating from her and found it in the high Tier 2 range, though she had so much of it she could contend with a Tier 3 if she gained enough combat experience. Not that I ever planned to let a child take to the battlefield. I would have to watch her. She might be mature for her age, but I didn't want to take any chances by releasing her into the world. It would be like giving a loaded weapon to a child. Not only did she have enough mana to level a city, she likely had the control to go along with it. I threw a blanket over her naked form, then called for Anna. She came down a few moments later.
"Yes, Master?"
The worry in her eyes was apparent, but it went away when she saw the sleeping child in my arms. "Same thing as with Ren. Take care of her until she is better. She probably won't trust you since you're not from the dungeon, but try to help her," I said, lifting the girl to better support her weight. I carried her upstairs to one of the many empty rooms, while Anna followed behind. Thanks to her mana sight, she could follow me with ease, given that my body was made from mana. As was the tower, now that I thought about it, she likely could see just fine in here.
"As you command. I have to ask, do you think this was a good idea, changing a child?"
I placed the girl on a bed, then looked off through a window as I thought about it. I didn't think I could answer that question. A logical person would probably have gone to find someone who could help the girl, perhaps her parents or family, or anything, really. I was a dungeon core, though. I wanted things that would make me more powerful, that would help protect what I considered mine. "From a moral standpoint, nope," I said, putting my hands in the air. "From my standpoint, yes. She has access to a mana type that is very rare from what I've seen."
"A rare mana?"
Anna asked, moving over to look at the girl straight on. She jerked back quickly with a gasp of pain. Rubbing her eyes, she tried to look at the girl from an angle. I could tell it didn't help much. "Gravity, or the force that keeps us from flying off the planet. I can play with it, but I want to see how a mortal will interact with it. My curiosity got the better of me. That, and she has the potential to be one of the most powerful personages on the continent," I said with a grin. I started to leave the room, then remembered Sophia wouldn't have anything to wear. I couldn't have my adopted daughter going around naked. I thought about the clothes I'd seen girls around the town wear, then shook my head. Most were simple. This girl deserved better. Plus, I felt like she was likely used to better. I pictured the dresses that princesses back on Earth wore and created a few of them while adjusting them to this world. I added gear and circuit designs so that people would know she was from the dungeon.
"Such beautiful clothing," Anna said.
I blinked, surprised, then realized she would have been able to see them while they were forming out of mana. With a laugh, I said, "If you would like some, just let me know. I am pleased with how much of a personality Gray and his brother are showing since they started interacting with you." I really was fascinated by the growth of the two. They were close to being, if not already, complete individuals. I knew that Gray's brother worried about his safety. Gray clearly cared for Anna in a way a mortal might care for another. "I couldn't," she started to say, but must have felt something from me as I started to glare at her. Most of my dungeon children knew that when I offered something, I didn't like to be told no.
"I shall let you know. Thank you."
She bowed her head, then moved around me to check on the child.
"I would like it known that I do take care of those I find interesting," I said with a chuckle, then vanished from the room and went over to the core room.
That little event had cost me more mana than I had wanted to use. Since she was a little kid, I'd figured it would be a couple thousand tops. No, she used 3 million and pulled mana from the ambient aura as well. It would be interesting to see what the little monster, I mean child, could do in the future.
"Regan,"
I heard, the voice coming from town. Sighing, I wondered what it was this time. I teleported and arrived in one of the sitting rooms in Luella's castle. She was sipping some type of hard alcohol and looking stressed. I knew it came from my dungeon, only I did not observe every detail of that section of the dungeon. The automata were constantly creating new brands.
"What do you need this late at night?" I asked, forming my avatar already sitting on one of the couches.
Luella bowed her head.
"Sorry, I know I bugged you a few hours ago. A few guests arrived here earlier, and the younger sister has vanished. Rather than scour the town for her, I thought it better to just ask you."
She put the glass to her lips and downed all the liquor in one go.
"Guests, you say?"
I cast my mind's eye over to where a young woman, more a girl just about to leave her budding years, was searching the castle frantically.
"All right, what's the girl's name?"
I tapped the armrest as I started focusing around the castle. This person was clearly important to Luella. Helping to find someone shouldn't take me more than a few seconds.
"Sophia Lekazar."
I paused mid-tap, which didn't escape Luella's notice, even with some alcohol in her system. "Damn higher-tier bodies," I thought with annoyance.
"Do you happen to know a Sophia?"
she asked with an arched eyebrow. I coughed, covering my mouth with my hand.
"I may have met said Sophia earlier this evening," I said, tilting my head as if thinking it over.
"Oh, fate, tell me she didn't wander into the dungeon,"
Luella said, rushing over to me and grabbing my shoulders. I didn't fail to notice that she was able to put dents in my metal shoulders.
"Define what you mean by into the dungeon," I asked, still playing dumb, as I wasn't sure how she would take the real answer.
The entire town was in my aura, after all.
"Is she alive, damn it?"
Luella asked, just short of screaming at me.
"Yes, I can confidently say she is indeed alive."
I lifted my finger up in the air as if making a point. She calmed down considerably and stepped back.
"Thank goodness. Well, where is she?"
she asked, putting her hands on her hips. I decided to change the subject in a way.
"On another note, do you remember Azra?"
"Huh? The slave girl you changed?" "Regan, you didn't!"
Luella shouted. I forget she had a faster processing speed now since she'd become a partial elemental. I would have to think of higher level stuff to tease her later, just to help her get used to her new abilities.
"In my defense," I said, holding my hands up as arcs of lightning popped off her skin. They wouldn't hurt me, but it was the fact of the matter. I didn't know she was a princess, and she seemed to pretty much hate all other mortals. Given her type of mana, I thought it was in the best interest of everyone to take her under my wing, so to speak. The lightning died down.
"Chloe is going to kill me,"
Luella said, putting her face in her hands and dropping to the couch.
"As long as your head survives, I can make you a new body," I reassured her, clapping my hands. It never hurt to be as encouraging as possible. I heard a groan from her and had to hold back a laugh. It always made my day to tease her.
Chapter 3. Louella. Explaining to an old friend why her sister had bound herself to the dungeon took more effort than I ever wanted to use. Between her being angry, sad, or just confused, the conversation lasted most of the night. I could tell her guard wanted to comfort her, but given his station, and the very fact that I was in the room, he was forced to keep his distance. I wanted to leave them alone, but felt that wouldn't be right. Plus, whenever I tried to hint at leaving, Chloe would shut me down fast. "I want to see her," Chloe demanded, grabbing my shoulders. I could tell by her eyes that she was getting close to the edge. I couldn't imagine the time she must have had traveling here. That, coupled with her sister joining the dungeon, she must have been close to snapping. I needed to help ease her worry. "I know. I will make sure you get to see her soon. Please, for now, just retire to a guest room and clean up. I have it in good confidence that she will be fine," I said, placing my hands over hers and pulling them in front of me. At the sensation of dense terra mana starting to form from her, I narrowed my eyes and sent a small surge of lightning mana through her hands. She yelped and yanked her hands back, then looked at me in surprise. I pointed toward the guard without even looking at him. I'd sensed him tensing when Chloe had started to channel mana. "I will not have anyone using force around here to get their way. That includes you," I said, with arcs of lightning dancing on my skin. I loved Chloe. She was an old friend, but I had enough people who wanted to throw their weight around to get their way. I wasn't the same fragile girl from a few months ago.
I'm sorry. I will wait," Chloe said, letting her arms drop to her sides.
"Good. Mr. Guard, please go with the princess. There is an adjoining room that you can use," I said, turning to Chloe's guard, who had a white-knuckled grip on his sword. I wasn't sure what was going through his head, but I'm glad it ended with him removing his hand from the weapon. His tier wasn't completely clear to me, but I was sure I was higher than him. Plus, I was in my castle. When I rang a bell, a few of my guards entered and escorted the two from the sitting room. This was truly turning out to be an interesting day. Never thought I would have the princess from the country I used to live in be escorted by my own guards. I found I didn't mind it too much. Opening the window, I looked out to find it was well into the night. The stars shone, with the moon Krona nearly full just above the horizon. Clouds that seemed to promise the first snow creeped along the night sky. It would have been beautiful if I didn't have so much to worry about on my plate. I took a breath of the night air and left for my office. Sleep beckoned, but there was just too much to do. I looked up from the document I was working on when the first light of day shined through the east window. I'd reached a good stopping point with the plans for the refugees. I didn't have an exact idea of what kind of setup Regan was going to use, but these guidelines were just the foundations for future plans. Though, knowing Regan, I'd likely have to redo most of them after today. Leaning back and cracking my neck, I considered what I should do today. There were plenty of nobles in the city right now who all wanted a meeting with me. Almost every village and town west of the Lekazar capital was decimated, their occupants forced to flee, and their town leaders or mayors needing to see me. I felt like there wasn't enough of me to go around. Due to the terrain, most went to the southern pass, but quite a few came here. That included nobles. I pulled a report from the stack and rechecked the numbers listed. Regan was right. The town had a population of 362,000 as of yesterday at gate close. If there wasn't a dungeon in the valley, I doubted we would be able to last more than a day before riots and other crimes of need started to take place. I really needed to tour the town. It had been a while, and I wasn't even sure what the second district looked like anymore. Even when I left, I usually flew to where I needed to go to save time. Basically, I knew my town had some really nice rooftops. It had been nearly 2 weeks since Regan's dungeon was attacked. With the number of refugees and other immigrants, I was sure there were a lot of changes to the town taking place on a smaller level. With the town growing,
A lot of autonomy I had was gone, and I was forced to hire out people who could manage the work for me. Otherwise, I'd work myself to death. There was a knock at the door, pulling my attention. Yes? A guard opened the door. I think it's one of Lord Regan's, my lady, he said with a head bow. All right, let them in. I waved him forward. The door opened all the way, and a girl walked in. It actually took me a moment to realize it was Sophia. She'd changed considerably. Mainly her silver metal skin and eyes. There was a blue light coming from her eyes that appeared strange even to me, and I thought I was getting used to strange things from dealing with Regan. Sophia, is that you? I asked, after I recovered my thoughts, then rushed around the desk. I was about 2 meters from her when she held up her hand to stop me from approaching. There was a pressure around her that I didn't want to test in the middle of my office. I complied, not wanting to push the girl. I could feel a tremendous power hidden in her. Where is my sister? Sophia asked, with a voice that was more like bells ringing. In one of the guest rooms. I can take you to her, I said, kneeling in front of her so we were eye level. She took off into the distance for a moment, then back to me and nodded. I stood and walked around her. Out in the hall, I asked the guards to lead me to Chloe. The guest rooms were on the other side of the castle for security reasons, as Regan put it. A good half an hour later, and down many halls that I'd never seen before, we finally made it to Chloe's room. A full squad of guards protected the hall. I couldn't have anything happen to Lekazar's princess, after all. They all saluted when they saw me, and I nodded to them. Walking over to Chloe's door, I knocked on it, hoping I wasn't disturbing her. I knew she needed a good rest. I think 3 seconds passed before the doors were flung open. Sophia! Chloe shouted. My eyes widened when I saw what she was wearing. Chloe, think of where you're at, I said harshly, then glared at the guards around us, but they had all been tactful enough to turn their heads. Chloe hadn't dressed before throwing the doors open, and only wore some rather sheer underclothing. I was sure they breathed well, but they weren't something a princess should show to a group of guards. Chloe looked down at herself and shrieked loudly enough to cause glass to vibrate. Her guard rushed from the connecting room with his weapon bared. Chloe ran back into the room while I pulled the doors closed and told him that everything was fine. I mentally made a note to give these guards a raise. A few minutes later, the doors opened again at a more reasonable speed. Chloe stood dressed in a simple dress. My apologies. Please forget that, she said, with a red tint to her cheeks. I knew she was directing the statement more to the guards than myself. Her guard stood at the ready, not wanting to be outdone by my own. It's all right. I moved to the side so she could see Sophia. Sophia! Chloe cried again, and tried to rush forward to pull the girl into a hug. Sophia jumped back and lifted, drifting backward a few meters in the air as if on the wind. Chloe looked devastated, but held it in. Do you hate me so? Tears threatened to start flowing down her cheeks at any time. Sophia shook her head. I have a person I can trust, so don't worry about me. Why don't you trust Dylan? I tilted my head, but noticed the guard who had come with the pair just barely jerked. I wondered what the story was there. Sophia, how can you trust something not even mortal? It doesn't care about you, Chloe cried, falling to her knees, tears rolling down her cheeks. I thought I could trust my own flesh and blood. I won't make that mistake again, Sophia said. Then the pressure in the hallway doubled. I was able to take it, but most of the guards, who were all mid-tier two, collapsed or fell to one knee. When the pressure vanished, I found that Sophia had vanished as well. As one of Regan's bound minions, she would be able to move quite freely in his dungeon, and everything in a 1,000-kilometer radius was his dungeon. Again, I was glad he was on our side. I couldn't imagine what might be if Regan were a bloodthirsty monster at a core. Louella, what should I do? Chloe asked, grabbing hold of my hands. I kneeled and patted her hands. Let's give her some space. I trust the dungeon host. He treats almost everything inside those walls as his children. She won't be forced to do anything that she wouldn't do herself. She stared into my eyes, and I met them without breaking away. Finally, she blinked and nodded. I helped her to her feet and took her back into the room. It looked like she hadn't slept a wink last night. Once she lay down, she fell asleep almost instantly. Closing the door quietly, I turned to the guards. Don't spread this around. They all nodded quickly, one even saluting me. I smiled, then left the guest hall. It was doubtful that Chloe would wake any time today, so I would hold off and give her a tour another time. Azal. Move it! I shouted at the recruits, who were doing runs to build their stamina. While there were many strong volunteers in the militia, they were all usually lacking to my eyes. Only a few were able to keep up with my regimen. Most of those who could were former slaves that Louella had rescued with Regan's device. With the necromancer attack on the Lekazar Empire, the number of slaves streaming into town and the forest tower were almost a third of the refugees. Many even chose to brave the new undead hordes to the east to come here instead of Thonica. They would just be forced back into slavery if they were caught anyway. The courtyard shook as Bruce and Des went at it. They had been practicing for a few weeks now since the dungeon was off limits. Fireballs of all shapes and sizes exploded as they impacted the two. While fire couldn't harm them directly, the impact and collateral, blasted dirt and stones, could. They also served to inspire each other's control over fire. A loud roar came from the other side of the courtyard as the bear beastkin ex-slave was fighting Chips. The two slammed into each other like wild animals. It was strangely captivating to watch. They weren't even using weapons, and I felt they could take on 10 each of the other recruits in the courtyard. After several long minutes, the recruits finally finished running their rounds and dropped to the ground in front of me, breathing heavily. I could only shake my head at how disappointing they were. Is this really the best you can do? I asked the assortment of sweating men and women.
Fat cow,
I heard one of the recruits say under his breath. I considered for a moment, then sent a ball of flame that streaked across the open courtyard almost faster than the eye could follow. There was a loud bang as the recruit was sent flying nearly 10 meters. I snapped my fingers. Damn, only 10 that time, I cursed.
Must be due to the pregnancy.
You're getting pretty far along, my second said from next to me.
Kid's probably going to be one of the best fire mages to be seen.
I turned to her. He is pulling more mana lately. The midwife assured me it was normal. My second, Orina Terst, was a fairly powerful warrior with the Terra aspect. With green hair and darker skin, she reminded me of a tree sometimes. She was high tier 2 and could hold her own in just about any fight, which was what earned her place. Bruce had stepped down from the position when the Inquisitors came looking for him.
The more mana the mother has to give, the easier it is for the child to cultivate it. That is the most accepted belief right now. Not sure if it will change in the future, thanks to Lord Regan's hospital. They are giving gold to anyone injured, pregnant, or otherwise to come in and get a checkup, Orina said as she looked at a report.
I've been a few times, I said with a nod. I got paid quite well, but it never hurt to have a nest egg for the future. I turned back to the recruits. Go get lunch. Be back in... A massive roar echoed throughout the air, interrupting me. There were a few gasps from the gathered recruits. I looked toward the direction the roar came from, Lord Regan's dungeon. From it, two forms cast shadows over the ground. I focused and made out two dragons flying over the valley. One was white, while the other was black.
What the hell now?
Orina said next to me. Hey, at least they're not attacking, I said with my hands on my hips. I found that was always a plus if you lived in this valley. Chapter 4. Azora. Gears of all sizes surrounded me, all working together in perfect harmony. A path that led off into the distance stretched out before me. I had been here before, only from a farther out view. I was sure I was in Lord Regan's mindscape. The questions now were, how had I gotten here, and what was I supposed to do? I started walking to the sounds of gears turning. They seemed to be perfectly in sync, creating a calming ambiance. As I walked, I tried to remember how I came here. I vaguely recalled walking to the sound of chanting, as the people on the airships were rallied by the captains. I had been so moved that I... That was where I was coming up with a blank. I didn't know how long I walked before I came to a large tower that extended as far as I could see into the sky. There didn't appear to be an end to it. It was built from an uncountable number of gears, and the farther up I looked, the more intricate the lines joining the gears were, turning at right angles. I looked around, but couldn't find another path to take. When I turned back, the path I was on was unpassable, as gears moved and changed position, blocking the way I'd come. I guess I'm going in, I muttered. Turning back to the building, I walked to the entrance. I couldn't help but stare as I walked inside. A spiraling staircase extended up. Strands of light ribboned around the staircase. I sensed a massive power from them that was similar to mana, but different at the same time. Moving closer to one, I felt another person's thoughts from it.
This isn't the first time you've been here, girl, said a voice.
I spun around and found Lord Regan standing next to one of the walls. Only something about him felt off. I couldn't quite place it, though. Lord Regan? I asked, not able to shake the feeling. He nodded.
Though not the one you're used to. I am one layer of my subconsciousness. I'm what could be considered image. How I see myself. Feel free to call me as such.
So there are others in this tower, I asked, looking up. And what are these?
Indeed. But it's best if you don't ascend too far. You might lose yourself in my mind. Wouldn't want that, would we?
Image said with a chuckle. He turned to look at the ribbon of light.
Those strands form when people devote themselves to my cause. Mane, the one you interact with outside, hasn't touched them yet.
Interesting. I looked around. How do I get out, then?
Transporting your entire fleet at once took a lot out of you. But you've been in my dungeon for several weeks now. You just need to trace your link back to your body.
Image explained.
You've had plenty of practice.
My link, huh? I sat on the ground and turned my focus inward. Most people learn to cultivate mana at a young age. People with better resources usually have access to better cultivation techniques. As a royal family member, my cultivation method was pretty powerful, if I said so myself. Because I was a multi-aspect, cultivation took a bit more effort. I had to keep the elements balanced, or I could end up hurting myself. I sent my senses out, but could only feel one type of mana. I could only assume that it was Lord Regan's personal mana. There was so much of it, like an ocean. Even though the ocean was a bit low, it was quickly filling up. While cultivating, I had felt other people's mana before, but Lord Regan's felt strange. I couldn't remember ever feeling a mana type like this. I believe the word Lord Regan used was circuitry. Lines of energy pulsed through the connecting mana nodes that were then connected to an ever-increasing number of nodes. It was fascinating and captivating. I looked around, then at myself, and noticed there was a node in my body.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.